vocal talent. I want you to welcome him now for what is a very special performance with his first song of the night. Show your appreciation for Mr. Mark Feehily, ladies and gentlemen.
I'll sing it one last time for you. Then we really have to go. You've been the only thing that's right, and all I've done. But I can barely look at you. But every single time I do, I know we'll make it anywhere away from here. Now, light up, light up, as if you have a choice. Even if you cannot hear my voice, I'll be right beside you, dear. To think I might not see those eyes makes it so hard not to cry. As if you have a choice, even if you cannot hear my voice, I'll be right beside you, dear.
Mark Feehily, ladies and gentlemen. Amazing. Yeah, good to see you, Matt.
Let's get these things out.
Yeah. Have a seat and welcome aboard.
Thank you.
You know, I remember when you came in not too long ago with the lads, and I was watching you performing Flying Without Wings, and I said, there's a solo artist in you, obviously, that you can hear right there. What age were you when you went, I've got this instrument, I've got this thing? You were in Sligo, obviously.
Yeah, when I was young, I was very shy in many ways, kind of quiet. I spent a lot of time at my granny's house on a farm. So socially, I suppose, when I went into school and stuff, I wasn't like kind of Mr. Ballsy kind of, you know. Yeah. I was kind of a bit of a wallflower, really, you know.
Yes.
But I sort of discovered quite early on that the one thing that I had no fear in whatsoever was singing, you know. There's some kind of inbuilt confidence that I wish I could only have, like, in lots of other places in life. But I don't know, it was just, I mean, there's some people that play sports or are carpenters, and it's not a cockiness, it's more that...
Confidence.
It's a confidence, yeah. It's like, I know what I am, I know what I do, and that's one thing that singing has always been for me, yeah.
And where were we able to get the outlet for that?
Well, I suppose I was looking for one. There was a lot of good outlets for kids. I think in Ireland in general, you sing a lot in school and stuff,
yes.
And great local theatre and kids' kind of performance arts stuff in Sligo, but... the first thing that I'd done, it's quite mad because if you knew me as a person,
yeah,
I would literally, like, as I say, wallflower, really quiet and shy. But I put my name down for the school talent competition.
Okay.
Because it was singing and I just didn't care. And I was a second year, I think it was about 12 maybe.
Yeah.
And the rest of the competitors were like leaving certs and repeat leaving certs in full-blown rock bands and stuff. So it was just like me kind of singing in a high-pitched voice against like all these leaving cert rock bands.
Do you remember what you sang?
I sung, actually, the weekend that's in, I sung Rock and Roll Kids as my first song.
Paul Harrington, yeah. Charlie McGettigan,
and
my goodness.
I sung Let It Be by the Beatles.
Oh, well,
and I sung the same verse three times because I forgot the word. But anyways, the point is, I got up there and I didn't care.
Yeah.
I just sung.
You're happy.
You know, like I was in my bedroom, you know, because that's kind of where I learned how to sing in my bedroom. Just close the door and turn up the stereo, singing along with, like, you know, Alanis Morissette and...
So when you got into Westside, fast-forwarding a few years, the young man you've described there doesn't seem like a good fit for a boy band or a big band like that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I was just like, anything I can do to sing, I will do. So the suggestion, like IOU, which is the band that kind of became Westlife, yeah, formed in school, you know.
Yes.
I actually met Shane the night of that talent competition I was talking about. He was the first person to come up to me afterwards and he was like, oh, we have to sing together someday.
Really?
Little did we know what would happen. But yeah. I was like, boy band, whatever. If I get to sing, yes. If I get to go to a recording studio, yes. I got to go into rehearsals, be in a band and sing all the time. I didn't think about anything else. And then all of a sudden, slowly but surely, I started realising, oh, hang on a minute, we have to do photo shoots, we have to do interviews, we have to go into rooms full of people from the industry and, like, as Louis would say, work the room, you know? And I was really bad at that because I was just kind of quite, not withdrawn, I was just reserved, you know?
Shy.
I didn't know how to talk all the bullshit.
So, but there's a shyness to that too, I take it.
Yeah, and, I suppose shy, yeah.
Because when you get into that zone then, you're in the Westlife world, how do you marry the demands of that pop world versus your own personality, which is, as you say, slightly withdrawn?
Well, there was a lot of times where I just sort of said, right, I have to like put on a smiley face and be on like SMTV
Showtime
every Saturday morning. You know, I don't know, I'd say we probably were on SMTV more than Ant and Dec was, but... you know, you do sort of step up to it. And, you know, every job has something that you have to kind of, you know, pull yourself a bit more in that area because,
yes,
you know, it's not natural. But there was certain parts of it that just didn't marry, you know. I just got on with it. Like, I really never liked the camera being on me or I never liked... I'm, like, behind the camera. I've loved photography since I was a child,
yeah,
but
yeah,
to be in front of the camera is a different thing.
What were you self-conscious of?
I was just conscious of my weight. My weight always fluctuated. I mean, you know, I don't know, it's weird because when I was young, I never realised that I was, like, and I'm fluctuating in and out of, like, a little bit overweight. Not, like, you know, really overweight or anything like that, but, you know, I always fluctuated in and out of it. And, you know, obviously, I was in an all-boys school and, you know, you're very quickly kind of reminded. Nicknames just, like, you know, come out of, you know, any tiny thing that's different about you, you know.
So you...
Anyways, yeah, like, there was a few nicknames in school, but, you know, to be honest with you, it wasn't too bad, but
okay,
to all of a sudden be like, okay, now there's like, and before you go on TV shows, of course, like, you know, there's like 14 million people watching this now, you know, and there's actually 50 million people watching this one, and, you know, and you're like, oh my God. And then all of a sudden, all I can describe it as is, you know, when the camera's on you, it's like, say if the camera's here, it's like, it just kind of felt like a weight on my face. It felt like it just wasn't right, you know what
right
I mean? I just didn't, it was an inbuilt thing that didn't feel natural to me at all. And so that, and look, it's the music industry. Things are a bit different now. But back then, people would have no problem telling you, you're fat, lose weight.
Did they?
Like, just before you went on camera, just before you went on
that
a TV
was said
show
to you?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Like, you know, I mean, I'm not, like, singling anyone out. And it's not, like, you know, not going back kind of in that way.
No, but it was a common occurrence.
Well, I'm describing my experience, I suppose. Yeah. And
what does that do to you, Mark, when somebody makes such a comment about your physical...
Well, it's like there's 40 million people about to watch it.
Yes.
And you're fat.
Well, yeah, so how do
so
you...
So it's obviously not...
But how
not
do you
great,
feel when you,
know?
You hear that?
I was like, you know what, I forgot about that until you told me. I was actually just ready to go and sing and all of a sudden someone reminds you. And I think that describes me as a person. I'm never really too aware of, you know, I'm kind of comfortable enough in my own skin. It's only when other people tell me. And I think there's lots of people like that. And I think now, instead of it being somebody from the record industry or something, it's Instagram or it's Twitter or it's, you know, and I mean, it's...
She's a Heat magazine were cruel, weren't they?
Yeah, well, I mean, I wasn't going to name any names, but, you know, there was times where, you know, like, I played a lot of tennis when I was a kid, so there was this charity tennis event on in London. And I was like, yeah, I'd definitely love to play in that, you know, because I haven't played tennis in years. And I went along and, you know, there's loads of photographers there and stuff like that. There was like Jonathan Ross and all sorts of celebrities playing in it. And a week later, I opened Heat magazine. And there I was, like in the middle of a serve. And if you can picture someone serving in tennis, you're bent over in two. And my T-shirt had sort of ridden up my stomach, if you know what I mean. And my belly was kind of showing. And they had kind of like done that whole circle of shame thing. And then they, you know, they take like the little bit. It could be a double chain. It could be something that's wrong with the celebrity. Yeah. And they sort of circle it and blow it up, you know, magnify
it. Yeah.
And I was just opened it. And I was just like, it just like destroyed me. You know, this is like mid, not Midwest life, but like, you know, we were well in our flow at that point. And so I suppose that's something that has always been a part of my life since I was a teenager, you know, is... just it's floating in and out of just a little bit overweight sometimes and then not, you know. But anyways, the point is a lot has changed and we no longer accept stuff like that. I mean, it still does go on, but, you know, it's not seen as okay anymore, you know, and that's the important thing.
So much has moved on. I mean, we talked about sexuality and there you are in the band. And let me ask you about confronting or being confronted. How do you describe that? What happened there?
You mean with coming out?
Yeah.
Well, so when I came out, I think it's like 17 years ago now, I've stopped counting at this stage, but when I came out, I think I would say I was in a relationship and I was kind of not caring that much if people seen us kind of walking somewhere together. Mm. But I was ready to come out, but I didn't have the balls to just go and do it.
Okay.
Procrastination, etc. And one day I got a phone call from somebody that works around us and they were just like, look, the son, know you're going out with someone, a man, and... basically they're going to print the story, so they want to know, do you want to come and talk to them and explain your situation or not, you know, because it's going in the paper either way. So that was sort of unexpected, and I don't look back in anger at that. I don't think anyone should have to come out that way in a forced way, but it's what happened to me and life got better after it. So,
strangely.
So not, you know, something, every cloud is a silver lining, basically. I think I would have eventually came out, but maybe it would have taken me longer. And so, you know...
Forced the issue.
Yeah, you sort of just take the good out of it, you know. But thankfully, once again, it's another thing that, you know, even in the media industry, like they wouldn't even consider doing something like that now. And, you know, it's just something that used to happen nearly 20 years ago and it doesn't happen anymore. But
in the years that I've been interviewing you, mostly with the other lads, to be honest with you, but I don't think I've ever seen you as happier as when, if you don't mind me saying so, as when you became a dad. I think your whole demeanour, personality maybe, but certainly I know for a fact, because we've talked before, that your life changed for all the right reasons.
Absolutely.
Talk to me about Layla.
You're going to start getting me emotional. No, the thing is, I mean, there's something that having a child has unlocked in me, and it's that you don't have time to think so much about yourself, honestly.
Yeah,
you know, maybe I had far too much time to think about myself and I kind of went in too deep, you know. I think, like my friend said to me the other day, you're always better and happier when you've got some sort of project in front of you, you know. And of course having a child is more than just a project, but like everything I do now is there's me and her in a field. We're outstanding in our field.
Outstanding in our field, yes.
So,
that's
of all the things. But anyways, she, everything is through the eyes of a father now.
Yeah,
you know,
of
everything
course.
I do, even when me and Kaelin go down the country, say to a hotel for a night and have a little night to ourselves or a night off, it's still we're still like, yeah, let's just go to bed. Like, you know, we want to be back tomorrow and we don't want to be hungover too badly. That doesn't always work out. But, you know, what I mean? It's like
that's
everything.
That's the three of you together.
Yes, that was on Kaelin's birthday and lots of balloons, really. The balloons were for Layla.
How would you describe Layla's personality? What is she like?
Well, she's a bit like me in the sense that she hates being told what to do. she's really lovely. Like, we are kind of quite lucky. She's happy-go-lucky.
Great.
She's very much her own person. She sings all day, every day. Don't know how she...
Where she got that from.
Yeah, yeah. In fairness, she's been listening to me since she breathed her first oxygen.
Of course.
But she is... Just and every day, I mean, it's mad, but like you hear people saying this, and then when you go through it yourself, you're like, oh God, they were actually really talking sense there. But it's like every time she does something new, you know, Like the other day, like I always like be tickling her at the bottom of her feet, but the other day she was like, "Daddy, tickle my feet." Yeah. And I was like, "Oh my God, she just said a sentence."
Yeah, you know, yeah,
like,
yeah. It talks.
But honestly, like it's like the amount of joy that brings me. And then sometimes you've been doing stuff that everyone might think is like the best thing in the world, and you're playing to this many people and everything, and you mightn't feel anywhere near as happy as that. So it's beautiful little things, you know. My little daughter makes me happier than anything I've ever done.
Well, congratulations. It's a lovely event in your life. I'm very happy for you both. For the three of you, I should say.
Yeah, it's absolutely. Great news. Family, I love it. Family.
And Layla arrived into the world. It came to you by surrogacy. We've spoken briefly about the surrogacy because you're very passionate about it, and you want things to change for not just you, but for families around the country. Is that fair to say? You know.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, it's strange. Anyone who knows me like knows that I would never, like, I'm in this as a dad, and I'm like, oh God, yeah. I actually have a bit of a platform here.
Yes.
And for once, it'd be really lovely to do something meaningful and useful with it, instead of just kind of. And it's all great to come on and say, "Oh, geez, it was brilliant doing duets with Mariah Carey and all that stuff." But, but like to me, like to do something meaningful with my platform, I think that's become more important to me recently. And so, like honestly, it's strange to be on the Late Late talking about something that's politically driven, and I'm not even going to get into that. But but my point is, I'm here as a father. You know, I'm here like that photo of me or Layla and Caelan a minute ago. I'm here for them. I'm doing what any father would do if they could help their child in any way, you know? And that's why I'm involved, you know? And I'm passionately involved because any parent would be passionately involved.
Yes, and you want resolution, obviously. I mean, it's been rolling along for a time now.
Listen, there's a lot of stuff happening. At the end of the day, I think, like, sometimes people can confuse this as, like, there's, like, a few people, like, up in Dublin that have kids through surrogacy.
Yes.
Like, every time you go in a playground, every time you go into your local supermarket or you go to the cinema or go to a restaurant, I guarantee you that somebody there is either knows somebody or has gone through surrogacy themselves. It's very, very common, and it's not always something that people sort of wear on their sleeve. You know, they're just going about their daily business. Mm. But, you know, tomorrow I'm going to bring Layla to the playground, right, and I just want soon to be able to bring her to the playground and to let her off on the swing and kind of just feel like she's the exact same as every other kid. That's what any parent wants, is for their child to feel safe and to fit in. And at the moment, you know, there is laws that stop that separate her from all the kids in the playground or all the kids, you know, in the supermarket or in the school. And like it's not a big deal, actually. And everything is going in a very positive way, you know. It's making a lot of headway.
Yeah.
It's just that we're getting really nervous now because it's coming to the crunch time, and we're nervous that if something went the wrong way. But, you know, we've got full faith. I mean, in fairness, like...
You're optimistic.
Yeah, like, the Department of Health are fantastic. Stephen Donnelly is fantastic. He's leading the whole thing. And we are really hopeful that they just don't leave any child out and have them all equal, you know? It's common sense.
Well, the best of luck with it all, because as you say, it's a different side to you. But again, it's part of this new gear change in your life that you are kind of campaigning in the middle of everything else. The Masked Singer was a great success. Again, as you said recently, that you left a lot of stuff behind in that mask. I think that's quite a thing to say.
Well, first of all, I was like, when I got off, I was like, oh my God, I could actually sing. But like not have any of that camera stuff, you know, because you're inside this big costume, so nobody can see you. And I was like, it'd be really interesting to just sing on a big show like that, but nobody's looking at me. It'd be, for once in my life, I could just sing and not worry about what I look like, you know? And that kind of was an attraction. But then also, you know, I got to, like, they let me design the costume a little bit myself and get involved in it. And so I got to bring in a bit of comedy and show a bit of that side of myself, you know, with the bunny's voice. And they let me like get the, I was like, can
you
the bunny's
really went for it, didn't you?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, honestly, I set myself too much of a challenge at the end of it. I was wrecked. But
it was great. It was worth
it. It was a lot of fun and it was very liberating. And anyways, you were saying, like at the end of it, when I took the mask off, I actually felt like I had sort of somehow processed all that old stuff and just let it go, you know.
Isn't that great?
And so, yeah, and it's important to have done that because at the end of the day, I'm on camera a fair bit, so it's nice to be on camera and to not care as much.
What's the name of the song you're going to perform for us now?
So this song, I mean, look, as I said, everything in my life is really dedicated to my family and to my daughter. And I was thinking of so many different songs to sing tonight, and A very, very good friend of mine, Caroline Downey, suggested this, and it's called You Are the Reason, and I've got an amazing gospel choir with me, an amazing orchestra, and the band, by the way, who are amazing, and everyone's been so welcoming, including yourself and the producer. So, yeah, it's called You Are the Reason, and it's just says everything I want to say, and I think it's also something that hopefully everyone can enjoy the lyric, because it's just an uplifting song, so
I'll
give
me.
It a shot.
Great to see you. It's great
Thank
to see you.
Much.
So happy.
Cheers.
Okay, good luck with it. Okay, good luck with it. Mark Feehily, ladies and gentlemen, singing again for us tonight. A song which, as he says himself, is very special to him, very close to his heart, and a moment for all of you watching tonight. And what's so nice about this song, the way we were looking at it a little earlier on, because as Mark says, wonderful choir, great strings with us tonight, and the band itself, and an audience unmasked. The unmasked audience, even better again, and everyone close together like they should be. This is You Are the Reason. Once again, Mark Feehily.
There goes my heart beating, 'cause you are the reason I'm losing my sleep. Please come back now. There goes my mind racing, and you are the reason that I'm still breathing. I'm hopeless now. I climb every mountain, swim every ocean, just to be with you and fix what I've broken. Oh, baby, I need you to see that you are the reason. There goes my hand shaking. The reason my heart keeps bleeding. I need you now. I climb every mountain, swim every ocean, just to be with you and fix what I've broken. Oh, baby, you're the reason for everything.
Thank you, Mark. That was a knockout. Mark Feehily, ladies and gentlemen. Great stuff. OK, I love that. Mark will be performing in the Secret Garden at the Palladium Theatre in London's West End on top of everything. I think we should say once more for everyone involved in that wonderful performance. Once more, everybody, thank you. Really enjoyed that tremendously. All right. Let's keep moving on. Did you watch the Eurovision last night? Yeah, I know. We were robbed.